We're in a grid world.
Okay.
And you have to learn a reward function. You have to learn what's good or not good to do in this grid. And you're going to get to learn it by watching me. So I'm gonna control the agent. The agent's name is Frank.
Okay.
So he's going to go like this. And then he stays there. Okay?
Okay.
So I claim that you can actually make some very good educated guesses about how rewards work in this environment just based on that one little demonstration.
Yeah, I think that's probably true.
So is there anything that the agent finds positively rewarding?
Green.
Green, yes. Good. Is there anything that the agent finds aversive?
So I could guess that blue is aversive because you avoided the blue, but that also happened to be one of the shortest paths to get to the green.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. So it might have just been a coincidence, but I think you have some evidence that maybe blue was something I was trying to avoid.
Right.
What about red?
So red is not something you were trying to avoid because you could have avoided it.
That's right.
I don't know about orange because you couldn't avoid orange to get to green.
Excellent. And that was exactly the inferences that I was hoping you could make. So again, you can learn a tremendous amount about what's valuable and what's not valuable by not just the path that was taken, but in a sense by the paths that were not taken and what the other options are or were and what the other options weren't. Right. So you couldn't learn anything about orange. It could be that he hates orange, not as much as he likes green. So Frank was willing to go through orange and it didn't matter where. But red, yeah, totally could have gone around red and didn't bother, right? So that you can avoid blue and red just by going like that, but he didn't do that. So he probably is indifferent to red or something. So it's actually a really cool idea, and we can actually learn things about what people want to do and what they don't want to do, how tolerant are they of like sudden stops in a car or a bumpy road, that sort of thing. How do you trade that off against how fast you're trying to get to your destination? It's hard to get people to tell you numbers for that, but it's actually not so hard to have them demonstrate and then infer these kinds of values from their behavior. So, you know, obviously, as we're sitting here, we can't really get into the details of the algorithm, but just to give you a kind of a hint of the form of this, there's an algorithm that I worked on called maximum likelihood inverse reinforcement learning, but there's a whole bunch of different algorithms. This one I happen to understand the best because I helped make it up. And the basic game is here, guess a reward function. In this case, we were guessing reward functions that mapped colors to values. We then compute an optimal policy with that reward function in mind, measure the probability of the data, of the behavioral trajectories that we saw given that policy, and then compute a gradient on how can the value of the rewards change in a way that would make the data more likely. And then we just go back and do that again until we find something that is a local maximum.
Oh, that makes sense. How does that work in practice?
It seems to work pretty well. It can be slow, and it can get stuck in local minima, but we haven't really had significant problems with that. It actually pretty consistently comes up with a reward function that's pretty solid. There's tricky things like keeping in mind the fact that when I showed you the trajectory, I went through green and then I stayed there. So how do we represent that? Is this an absorbing state? And if so, do I just include it once in my trajectory, in which case it just saw one little green, in which case it's not so excited about green, or is it really important and it kind of sat there forever, in which case it really didn't see much of anything else? So getting those terminal states right can be a bit of a trick.
That makes sense. Okay. I like that.